presenting on the 10 most dormant technologies, Robert Nelson. And here's Robert. Round one of applause.
Thank you, John. And thank you for being here, my fellow humans, ETs and whatevers. The title of this presentation is 10 Dormant Technologies, a wake-up call, but actually that was just a catchphrase. There's many more. And I'm going to begin with what I call Fukushima, one or more. That's the explosion at Hiroshima. This is the movie that I cribbed the title from. I'd like to preface this before continuing. This presentation cost me dearly about a week or two after Fukushima blew up. I posted this file in its original form, and within days, my site came under attack to the tune of some 2+ terabytes a day of downloads until the server crashed about 2 weeks later. So someone out there does not like it, although I don't know why, unless they're utter psychopaths. That is the explosion of the reactor, and you notice the strange resemblance to, there's a sequence, there it is again, there's a post-explosion. This is a nuclear test in Nevada. And if you look closely, you'll see they're practically identical, except in color. Fukushima was not a hydrogen explosion. It was a nuclear blast. And apparently, according to Jim Stone, investigative reporter, it was caused by a company, a Mossad front company called Magna BSP, who had the task of security there, and are the party who installed the Stuxnet virus that caused the mechanical problems. However, the explosion was caused by what's called a gun nuke. It looks like a big stove, and they called it a camera, but it was completely unnecessary as such to have one that large. It was bigger than a refrigerator, when you know perfectly well there's small cameras will do just as well. So there again, Hiroshima. I'm going to present quickly at least some of the 60 plus methods for neutralizing radioactive waste, starting with Yul Brynn's legendary Brynn's gas generator. There's the patent, I think. And this was reported by Andrew McCroskey and Paringa at PACE, Planetary Association for Clean Energy. And this chart shows the effect of Brynn's gas. Within a matter of a few minutes of treatment, the count was dropped by some 90+% There's a typo in here, as pointed out to me not long ago. This is Dan Haley who presented this information elsewhere. The report says the Curies, but that would have been enough to kill everyone, so it must be something lower. I'm not a nuclear physicist, so I don't even know what is correct. But as the report says, using a slice of radioactive americium, Brynn melted it together on a brick with small chunks of steel and aluminum. After a couple of minutes of under the flame, the molten metal sent up an instant flash, and what Brynn says is the reaction that destroys the radioactivity. Continuing, these are just more details. And the next method is by Paul Brynn, deceased in a race car accident, drag car accident. Some people say it was a murder, but I think it was just bad driving. And he did this, proven by, I'm not a nuclear physicist. Yeah, gamma radiation, photo disintegration, and brought it down to a manageable level. He also invented a nuclear battery, the most powerful ever, and all of our waste could otherwise be used for that purpose, but no. Going on, Anatoly Kinderevich, there's a diagram. Ivan Shakhparinov, using a Mobius band and a dielectric base. William Barker, also known for low energy nuclear reactions, his approach was to use an electrostatic zap, as you can see, a Van de Graaff generator. And then there's Sidney Soloway, using an accelerator. This is a very small scale. I don't know how practical it would be. John Dash, and here's his patent diagram. Putsev, accelerator. Zizansky and Bolotov, using a ferromagnetic toroid. And then there's Ronald Brightson, again, of LANR fame. And there are some of the results. Marriott and Henyev, and then Takahiko and Sakano. This by Vitrac uses piezoelectrics. Again, Vitrac. Can't tell much from these diagrams, but if you're interested, the patents will explain it better than I obviously can. Then there's Kanarev and Podobedov. And you can see they were using alkali in their process. Litovsky and another type of accelerator. Ari de Guse and Kassam and Asodi, Fuchs and Forcado. Patent by Russian patent, Levadnev, Linghua, China, Charles Holden, Santilli, Rubia, Carlo Rubia, Konashi and Sasao, Heinrich Hora again, Charles Bowman, Fabio Cardone, Bowman again, and Manchin, accelerator again, another accelerator by Sidney Soloway, Vladimirovich Kinderevich et al., Kornilova, and Danilov, Taratorin. All these patents are in the public domain. There's nothing whatsoever secret about it, and it took no effort whatsoever to retrieve this information. All I did was go online to the European Patent Office, espacenet.com, and typed in three search terms: neutralization, radioactive waste, and or transmutation. It was the second search I did. And I came up with all of these. This is by Filomenko, there he is. And this is David Yurth, who took it all the way through some 10 years of research and development until he was prepared to present it to the DOE. At which point the meeting was canceled just a day before it was due to be presented. And this is his text in detail. But what happened later, as shown in this bit of text, he got a call from one of the heads, Goldner, at the DOE, who proceeded to scream at him and told them to lay off, in other words. And the DOE had no intention of doing anything but store nuclear waste. Well, that's not all they're really doing. The whole nuclear waste business is a front for extracting plutonium for weapons. So they don't want this to happen. And They, as I say, Earth and company, were using Ken Shoulder's EVs, shown here, and there's a basic launching mechanism. So much for Fukushima, although I would add that there are a couple of other issues there besides the radioactivity. One is that there's a river running under it, through it, and a Miocene fault line, and it's flowing over the corium, which is keeping it cool somewhat, but it's also washing millions and millions of gallons of highly radioactive water into the Pacific, which is now largely dead. Keeping track of that subject. The ice wall that was built is a fail. If anything, it should have been built uphill from the place to divert water from it. But if that had been done and successful, then the corium would have melted by now probably, and we'd had an even greater disaster. So it's a catch-22 conundrum. The other thing that could be done, they built the ice wall, and as a result, the ground all around those buildings is soggy and they're sinking. So the situation is actually worsening. However, there is a possible solution for that, two of them. One is electroosmosis, which is based on the fact that water is attracted to the negative pole. So, and this is an established technology. There are umpteen patents for it you can look up, but they're not being applied. And the other suggestion that I have for TEPCO and Yakuza, who run the place, is to lithify the soil, that's to say, add enzymes and some silicates, a nano works best as recently developed improvement, and within a matter of days, the ground could be solidified and that problem could be ameliorated considerably. We could buy some time, perhaps. Personally, I think that we should invade Japan and take care of it with a Manhattan-style project, and even bring in another nuclear reactor, such as the Russians have on ships. They have a couple of them, and park them there and power up this place. And just for another note, there's no need for enriching uranium or any of that, at least by the way that it's being done. Way back in the 1930s, there was a fellow named Gashler, G-A-S-C-H-L-E-R, who simply pumped DC direct current through radium and enriched it in a matter of hours. So there's another dormant technology for you. But don't try it at home, please, if at all. Now, going on to something completely different. This simple diagram is the basic structure of Leon Sprink's space activator, as he called it, which is just a geometry of wood with opposing poles charged up with some 50 kilovolts plus a couple of hundred kilovolts is better yet. And you let that stand for a few months, and it builds up a large field that enabled Sprink, who was running a cement factory in France, it enabled him to reduce the reaction time for his clinker production by some 80% with a 50% reduction in calories. That's run the numbers on that. It's impossibly dramatic. This is another illustration from this patent. Basically, you have to set it up vertically and orient it north-south, and then leave it sitting. And those squares on the side are the reactors or the furnaces. So it doesn't even have to be next to the operation. It covers a large area. I have one at home, which I don't use for anything like this. I just diddle with it, charging up herbs and whatever, alchemy projects. And I've noted a bizarre phenomenon. systematically and regularly overhead over an area of, well, I guesstimate about 10 miles circle, very, well, circular space. I produce a ring or a hole or a cloud, depending on what the surrounding weather is like. As, however, it's easily overwhelmed by chemtrails and 5G and whatever, so it's not omnipotent. More recently, and this is very recent, I think it was in Science Daily online, that's where I got this. This is a ceramics being treated at these temperatures and with an electrostatic charge, and they produced much improved quality and strength. And so there's something going on there with electrostatic charges, bears investigation. Sprink also did distillations this way and improved or affected liquids and chemical reactions. This was the simplest reactor, positive, negative, and another injector inside. His associate, Rabatin, forget his first name, I've got it here, excuse me. Jacques Rabatin, yes, had two patents for this, which is a very small unit. Sprink's devices were rather large, yards in size, whatever size you want, depending on the voltage you applied. Rabatin made these handheld and charged them up with 50 kilovolts and whatever. And you'll see those warps, I guess, along the curve outside. Those are Mobius twists, alternatively right and left rotation. And then he put in things like carborundum, and these handles are specifically shaped, and the electrodes came in to the center and from the sides, and this zone in here generated some phenomenal effects, to wit. After a starting time of about half an hour, effects on certain physical parameters considered to be invaluable for a given location within a radius of several tens of meters around the apparatus. Action on the Earth's magnetic field, gravitation, air refraction index, speed of plant growth, etc. The magnetic pole would shift by several degrees after about 15 minutes of activation with this device. And he lost up to, just in that same time period, in energy, and some 15% of weight. So who knows what would happen with megavolts pumped in there. You would think, if you ran the numbers exponentially and all that good stuff, that it would levitate outright. Now this is James Y. Johnson's dipolar resonance and anomalous dispersion mutation. Whatever that means, what it boils down to is he calculated relaxation time of dipoles when oriented in the field, the natural oscillation period of the dipoles, and the term difference frequencies of the atoms. And he was able to produce within minutes various phenomena, accelerated crystallization. And you can see some of these notes here. Milk kept fresh for nearly a month after a mere 5 minutes of treatment. Meat, likewise, juices, other chemical reactions, medicines were accelerated. Now, you'll have to find his patents. They're on my website if you're curious. This is one of my all-time favorite. This is Louis Rota, who, back around 1915, demonstrated this marvel, which he called the aeroradioballistique. And it was publicized in Le Matin newspaper on November 15th, 1915. And they titled it Jules Verne in Action. And I'll read this. Professor Louis Rota, that is his name, has invented an apparatus which triumphs over the laws of gravitation and is able to hold immobile in the air at a height of 500, 600, indeed 1,000 meters, a considerable weight. It is possible to move this apparatus at a prodigious velocity in any direction, and it may be stopped at any point at all, it is understood, without a mechanical motor of any sort, simply by using Hertzian waves. The principle of this invention rests on a special partitioning of electrostatic and magnetic forces, enabling forces of attraction and repulsion sufficient to maintain the apparatus suspended immobile. He actually flew this machine for hundreds of miles, as it was explained later and they described later in the article. Now, if you look closely, you'll see those knobs all over the frame. I suspect that those are not bolts, but rather coils that distributed the field. Rota also did some phenomenal studies of telluric radiation and developed these batteries of a sort of basic elements, zinc, iron, sulfur, and copper, and the like, and sandwiched them together, buried them into the ground, and then listened to the sounds that they picked up. And he was able to distinguish various elements such as silver, iron, and the like. So there's a very intriguing line of research waiting for your attention. But he applied that to this, and it started simply by pushing it along the ground. There was no motor necessary, although you'll see a propeller there. That was for insurance and extra control. And there's some very strange veins on the top, you notice. They aren't conventional, although I have seen pictures from from that time period of other models of that. Here's the of that propeller. I don't know what advantage it might have or what purpose it served there. But there's the headline. There's a patent diagram. And basically, it was a cylinder in a cylinder and surrounded by coils. So what you have there is very similar to later research by Henry Wallace in his kinematic generator, where he used half-spin elements such as, I think it was bismuth and some of the basics, these aluminum and several others. When you counter-rotate them, they generate a torsion field or another type of field. I like the term torsion. It needs refinement, but it'll do. And he called it the kinematic field. This device was also wound. Well, these are circular coils, obviously, but perhaps it shows elsewhere right here. He had flat wound coils, which very closely resembled Hooper's motional electric field, which also lost weight. So there's something going on there that cries for attention. Moving on, this is a favorite of mine. Frater Antonio, Antonio D'Angelo, pardon me, a little stage fright moment, and what he called his interatomic ion motor, which he got publicity for here in Popular Science, I believe it was, in 1928. Just started it up with a battery, and there he is close up. This was from Popular Science, which also featured him. And in that article, he stated quite clearly that it simply started with a battery and then produced many times more power than it used. And he was a Jesuit priest. So while the Jesuits may be fully capable of torture and assassination and inquisition and all that, surely he wouldn't be lying about this. There's no object to that point to it. And he wasn't into it for the money. He just did it. So there's the patent description of sort. I think somewhere in there it says, it results in an increase in the electromotive force developed in the secondary circuit. And the odd thing about this is the way it's wound. It goes around two poles and then cuts back and then back and forth and back and forth, commutates, et cetera, et cetera. And it's in that back and forth winding that these enhanced effects come into play. And this has not been replicated. It's just a sleeper, another view. And with us, he had several transformations of DC to AC and transformations up and down voltage and so forth and so on. This is one of my all-time favorites, Palmer Craig, who invented this while he was in the university, I think it was of Chicago, and did this as his PhD synthesis. It comprises nothing more than vapor deposited films of bismuth on mica, sheets of mica, interlaced with flat wound coils. Of course, when you hear flat wound coils, you probably immediately think of Tesla non-inductive coils, which he did not use, but which might be applied here to improve it all the more. And with these variations, he was operating radios with Earth energy at Earth magnetic field strength. The Hall effect is at play here, but when it's applied to thin films and stacked up in an additive series manner, it takes on new characteristics, which are still completely neglected. There has been some research in thin films. You just look it up, and you'll see that when you get down to that level, that the crystal shape changes and it starts generating phonons. So that may be the culprit there. And then going on, Roy Myers. This fellow was a prisoner in Arizona State Prison back in I think it was 1912. And he got permission to build the model in the prison electrical shop. The first model he made, which was a little thingy, perhaps that was it, which produced 12 volts and powered the generator, replaced the prison's generator battery system. As you see here from the patent, it's magnets and various coils and the like. Here's another view angle of it. That V shape is zinc. Those are zinc plates between the poles of the magnet. And by elevating it and orienting it, and he also had some special treatment of the magnets. I don't know what it was. He never disclosed it, but it could not have been all that high tech considering the time period and his resources. So maybe it was just heat tempering and he was just being coy. This is his rectifier, mercury rectifier, which could be replaced, of course. Here's another view. The magnets were widely separated and set up on a tower. And the higher the tower, the greater the power. So it was a combination, apparently, of electrostatic field effects plus geomagnetism. And the zinc, again, we have zinc and iron. And these are half-spin elements. So who knows what's going on with that. And then continuing along the same line of atmospheric power, the first patented such system was by Palinskar. And he had a motor specially developed for this. And then there's obvious how he did it, balloons and electrodes. Next chronologically was one of the great sleepers by Guillot, who had a simple antenna. Just a device right here, a tabletop model, that was a mere 6-foot antenna. You see all those wires and then rectifiers and coils and the like, all the usual. The only thing that's unique about it, or at all unknown about it specifically, is the rectifier, which was filled with a mixture of carbon and other metals, powders. So the question there is whether it was done just as a loose mix. And I do mean loose, because in that time period, it was common to have rectifiers that were just tubes filled with powder, and it would do the job. But in his case, it may have been packed, it might have been layered, or just a mix of take your pick. And this is the details. You see, he had right and left long coils, which may have served to separate the polarities. And there's a complete circuit. And later came Poisson, Herman Poisson, who's quite famous for his work. And he actually built a system, not with balloons, although yeah, he did that, but this was the most powerful version. Between two peaks in the Alps, strung a cable, looks like 2,200 feet long, 200 feet, 50 feet high, and a network of wires with insulators to hold it off. And with that set up right there, he was powering a small factory. There's one of the insulators, so you get an idea of the scale of the thing. Whoops, I didn't bring it out. Oh, well. This isn't quite in the order that I planned it, but I'll go with this. Gregory Hodowanek, in the 1980s, invented the gravity wave detector, which used transistor noise and capacitors, basically, to detect gravity waves with this extremely simple apparatus. I mean, simple as your basic transistor radio. And here's another version of it. And with it, he was at an Apple computer to record the signals. He could detect novas. And there's the characteristic signature, and a supernova. And this is one of his great accomplishments with it. He detected the collapse of the black holes at the center of the Milky Way years before it was found by conventional radio astronomy. And there's some more of his recordings of the event. And again, and on the same line, he also eventually came into communication with what he thought was a civilization on Mars. This is a predecessor. This is a crude diagram. Arthur Matthews, Nikola Tesla's, one of his workers, who allegedly built this gadget, which would pick up cosmic rays and then transform them down to audio, and he could communicate with the planets, and that was his claim. He also said that with this device, he could bring elements from Mars and have it pour out. I don't know how true that was, but that's what he said. So there you have him. Yes, this is Luigi Pier Agena, or Agena, and his Ilios device, which is a combination of color, obviously, and coils, which set up in a wave pattern like that would, there he is, and here's his, another version of it. Those coils that you see, they're conical coils, thus wound counterclockwise, were one of the key elements in his processes. With these, he was doing a lot of healing and other transformations, and he covered a lot of territory. This was a box all lit up inside. Every side was illuminated. And with it, he claimed to demonstrate what he called the black sun. He said that the sun is not really lit up the way we see it. And alchemists say the same thing, and maybe true, I don't know. But I have never seen it. There's his diagram of the interaction, rhythmic interaction between Earth and the sun that was key to the operation of his devices. Those coils of his picked up on that. And with this device shown here, he would affect the weather, much like Reich. And this is a smaller version of that, which you see rotates. And here's a large version of that. You see the coils on that's a helicopter rotor. The coils on the top, after about half an hour of rotation, and this was witnessed by several Italian journalists and others, would cause rain or clear it, depending on the intent. This was his earthquake neutralizer. And there it is set up in the ground. And again, the counter rotation of the colors. I don't know, he never explained the importance of the colors, but he certainly used them and everything. And there's a detailed diagram of the construction. And he also had a monopole generator. And this is a curious device. It's a super microscope that he invented, which one column was normal light and the other was suppressed, and then by zigzagging back and forth through electrical fields, he was able to produce photos like this, which he called the magnetic atom. And of course, nowadays you see photos of atoms done with electron microscopes and what. This was his version of it, which makes you wonder about the intent of the operator and what affecting the results. He was visited by extraterrestrials who explained their system to him. This is his diagram of it, magnetic disks and rotation. And it required ley lines to operate. And these were extraterrestrials who visited him, not humans. In the same vein of weather control, this is the David Wells version of the Newman motor, which he slightly modified, and this I actually had in my possession for a few months, and it was incredible. I didn't even turn it on. I left it sitting, oriented north-south and vertical for about 2 weeks in Las Vegas. And one day I was passing through the living room and I saw the TV was on. I don't watch, but I saw it as the other people were watching. And the weather report was on. And satellite view of Las Vegas showed an astounding, perfect cross. Each arm was about 50 miles long, I could only guesstimate, and maybe 5 miles wide. And it must have completely baffled the weather people and whoever else was watching. The moment I saw that, I went, laid the thing down, and moved it around to break up the field as far as I could, and that was the end of that. He was able to affect weather from great distances and steer hurricanes, but you don't hear anything about it nowadays for whatever reason. Probably suppressed. In any case, it's a very dangerous technology, and much more so than Wilhelm Reich's Cloudbusters, which I've also worked with to my satisfaction. Here's a diagram and another. There's no secret about the construction. The only place to get confused would be in the commutator there. It's not very clear how that's set up, and there's replication. This is another sleeper by, excuse me a moment, oh yeah, Paul Dobler. Back in the 1910s or then about, he was experimenting with film in aluminum envelopes. They were stored in aluminum envelopes, shellacked varnished over, and when he scratched, when he developed some of his photos, he noticed spots on it, so he experimented further to figure it out, and eventually concluded that the shellac was shielding it. And when he carried on, he came up with photos like this, influence of aluminum strips on photo plates. And then he put it over flowing water and was able to detect streams, presumably under quartz. I don't know if this works under limestone, which of course has different characteristics, but with quartz and water you get terahertz. If you look up again eSpaceNet and terahertz generators, you'll see almost all of them use water in some way or other. So something is going on there. And depending on the width of the spread of the rays, he'd lay an array of these plates across the terrain and was able to determine the exact depth of the water course. He also detected minerals with it and oil. This was his synthetic generator. So he just pumped water through there, and when it banged around in the bulb, it would generate the same radiation. So you can try this at home. What we got here? Blonde glow. If this radiation, again unexplained, call it telluric, or blonde glow, call it N rays after Nancy France, where he lived. And what he was using to do this was there on the left. It's a Nernst infrared generator, which used rare earth salts heated up and then passed it through some filters. And he again was using aluminum. Aluminum seems to be very important in this field. And it would affect photographic plates. And he had prisms of various substances, like particularly of wood. And he would get this type of film effect. And it was always just a blur, it was nothing very distinct. So eventually, in a very short period, there were hundreds of papers were written about this. Dozens and dozens of very credible researchers were getting the effects, and of course some could not replicate it. One was a Nobel Prize winning physicist, R.A. Wood, rather flamboyant character, who did not succeed and went to visit Blonde Glow to learn more. And while he was there, he played some dirty tricks and he removed a wooden filter, a prism, from the machine, and was able to show, at least logically, that they were diluted. However, this is extremely low level photon activity, and as we now know, clairvoyance and night vision are accomplished in the ultraviolet range, and night vision, which is part of this because it was all done in the dark, requires adaptation and training. And as we also know, clairvoyance can be suppressed virtually instantaneously just by change of mind, say nothing of light and other factors, chemistry, whatever. So Wood showed that they were slightly diluted, at least psychologically. However, I have to point out, I've never argued in his defense or against or whatever, no one's ever really explained it away. If you have a regular microscope and you take out a lens, you're still going to get light coming through and you're going to get blurs. And that's all he ever had was blurs. So it's not surprising that even though the lens was removed, that he still got blurs or saw it. He may have been kidding himself about his visual perception, optical perception, but the photographs aren't lying. So that demands replication. Okay. Now, I'm going to wind this up a bit. with another subject, not necessarily suppressed, but nonetheless interesting, ray guns. This was Giulio Ulivi, who is an Italian, became notorious from 1913 when he claimed to have discovered F-rays in the infrared range that could detonate gunpowder from several miles away. And he demonstrated it, and but nothing was ever really proven, and he never patented it. I've repeatedly looked for patents for this, all of these people. And this fellow, Edgar Hollingshead, also had a ray gun, but he called it the Odic activity ray. And he also, aside from the death ray aspect, could cause substances to decompose, disintegrate without explosion, no ashes or smoke or residue, and water was instantly transformed into its component elements. And it also produced levitation. So he had two patents, or two or three Canadian patents for dynamos, which if you look at their diagrams and compare them with what you can see in these few photographs, you can see a resemblance, and they may be a clue to his lost secret, but no one really knows what's going on there. Konstantin Vedianu, in 1919, came up with this, which was a modulated RF beam imposed with a UV beam positive that caused photoionization and was able to, as he described it, amplify the initial beam over enormous distances. And when it strikes the target, a huge electrical discharge is produced with thermal and photic effects. At lower powers, it heats the atmosphere and causes climate disruption. It's just that. And this is the legendary Harry Grindle Matthews, who had a death ray, too, which he demonstrated and tried to capitalize upon, but never got anywhere because he was just too showy and secretive. Then there was this fellow, A. Roberts, first name unknown, who, this article is from Modern Mechanics, May 1929. He claimed to be the original inventor of the Grindle Matthews device, and it actually worked. He could stop engines with it, which reminds me, before I forget, there's a more modern researcher, Cornwell, I forget his first name, who used a Tesla coil, a microwave gun, but instead of pumping it up with your regular amplifier in straight AC and what all, he zapped it with overdrove it with a Tesla coil. And with that set up, which you can do at home, I'd like to hear about it if you do, he was able to turn off motors even in a Faraday cage. And when he turned it off, the motors would start again. So that's interesting, I would think. And here's Henri Claudel. That unlikely looking gadget claimed to be a ray of death that kills at 6 miles. And it was tested in public, and it claimed it could kill any living thing at a distance of 10 kilometers. Then Henry Fleer, 1930s, also proven with this gadget, directed his ray against a tree covered with fruit pests and killed them in half a second. The same ray swept another tree and annihilated thousands of spiders, ants, and aphids. In 1936, several disgruntled investors accused him of fraud and grand theft. At his trial before Judge George Steiger in San Francisco, Fleur was permitted to demonstrate his machine to the court, which reconvened to his home lab. There and then, he executed a snake in 8.5 minutes, a lizard in 6 minutes, termites within 30 seconds. The jury took only 4 minutes to acquit him. And his explanation was that it uses a bombardment of ultra-short electrical waves, which send down a beam of light to do the work. The waves are attuned to the normal bodily vibrations of the animals to be destroyed, and they simply explode. Harry May, I think this is his diagram of it, or maybe I'm out of order here. He also demonstrated a death ray at the California Pacific International Exposition in 1936, but he never published any details. And there it is, skipped something. Now, this is another legend, Dr. Antonio Longoria. Popular Science featured him in this photo in February 1940. Inventor hides the secret of death rays. Pigeon on the wing, instantly killed by death rays from a machine 4 miles away. He also demonstrated in court and was acquitted for whatever he was being charged with. He also destroyed it because he didn't want that one getting out. I looked up his patents, if any, and found that he had a welding device, which looks very much like that, so I would suspect that it's ultraviolet in some manner, because welders produce that, aside from whatever other frequencies, you know, broadband, and then he ran it through the lenses there, and zap. Let's see, it's out of order, but. And Otto Moore, and this may have just been propaganda, because it was done in World War II, and it just seems rather unlikely, the explanation. He called it a solar detonator, and it would be the antenna there on the top would pick up sunlight and convert it to infrared, which he'd then run through his brown box there and detonate from a distance, not very great. And that never went anywhere. And then, of course, our darling Tesla and his death ray, which was not to be confused with the wall of light and the like. Actually, it was it did use his Tesla mechanical, or rather his magnifying amplifier, the tower that we all know of. But the electrodes were the cover was it was covered with bunches of electrode balls that increased the power considerably, and then it was zapped out through this open ended tube, and that's how it was able to beam without any lenses and penetrate the atmosphere umpteen distance. Who have we got here? Nikola Moraru, who worked with Tesla, and his system comprised a water reservoir, pump, air compressor, and an injector. It was energized and with who knows what, and some 50 to 75 kilovolts. Apparently the Compton effect got involved to induce UV photoionization. All in all, it resulted in a superplasma and had a 10 megahertz carrier wave and radiated out of separate antennas, and when they were focused on a target, the raw power would combine and blow it to smithereens. Sid Hurwicz, back during the 70s, during the legendary raid on Entebbe Airport in Uganda, they used his invention, which he concocted just off the wall because he was feeling like a good citizen, and Toronto was being had a rash of robberies, bank robberies, and so he came up with a coil system to simply freeze any mechanical device and just stop, and it also quelled or squashed radar. Nothing more is known of it. And this is Troy Hurtubise and his so-called angel light from around 2004, inspired by a dream. And he saw it several times, and he finally constructed it, and it worked as he had imagined. It would see through walls and metal, stop engines and other electronic devices. It could also see through flesh, but it was toxic. It killed goldfish within minutes. And it comprised three units, a centrifuge of lights and lasers, a deflector grid, microwave generator, CO2 plasma, and some more ionizers. There's another view of it, and it definitely worked. Also caused burns. And finally, this is, in my humble opinion, one of the greatest inventions of all time and space and all dimensions and timelines. This is a new, improved swim fin that I invented. Simply a couple of coffee cans wired onto swim fins, and it channels the water and increases thrust by some 25%+. And there you have it, ladies and gentlemen, a brief glimpse into the wonder world of whenever. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have a few moments if we have any Q&A. The dinner, we just sent the message to Steve. We're going to have the groceries put on at 7:30. It was scheduled for 8, but we're just setting it up for 7:30, so you have a couple of minutes. If you have any questions for Robert, come on down. Please, once again, please use this mic so that they're on the DVD. Any questions? Answers? You want to cast any aspersions, make belittling comments, take humor at his expense? Come on up to the mic. You can take humor at my expense. You
know, everything that I've spoken of here is completely detailed on my website, rexresearch.com, which is offline at the moment. I'll be back in a couple of days. Yes, sir.
Has anybody from, say, mainstream academia quietly has bought any of your schematics from any of these inventors, but they don't want to admit it?
Well, yes, and specifically Apple. In fact, their director of research and development, Chuck Strong, was some few years ago, bought my DVD. Now it's a thumb drive. And so they know all this. And if you pay attention to what they are leaking, you can see they're off on some strange tangents. And I would not doubt that DARPA is all over it, and who knows who else. Personally, I'm not in communication with them and don't particularly want to be. I have no qualifications whatsoever. I'm a 10th grade dropout. All this is self-education on my part. So please don't expect any expert answers from me, but I'll say what I can for you, if anyone else. Well,
with that, a warm round of applause for Robert.